that bio if you don't mind, and you can add in anything. Tom here is a Broadway librettist who has collaborated on shows including Annie, The Producers, Hairspray, all of which won him the Tony for Best Book of a Musical. His other credits as a theatrical book writer include Elf, Bombay Dreams, Death Takes a Holiday, Rocky, Chaplin, Young Frankenstein, Crybaby, Ain't Broadway Grand, whole huge list. Just go to IBDB, you'll be astounded by the breadth of his work. Annie Warbucks, a personal favorite, many others. In addition to his theatrical work, Tom is also an Emmy Award-winning film and TV writer, including the beloved movie Spaceballs. Check out his IMDb profile as well. And he's also a regular contributor to The New Yorker for many years. I'm really pleased to be here and ask him some questions and then have you ask him some questions as well. So thank you for being here.
I'm glad to be here. I wish it wasn't 10 o'clock in the morning. But no, it's great. Thank you for coming.
Can you tell us first how you got started as a librettist of musicals?
Well, I was working on the New Yorker magazine, making a career of writing short stories, parodies, and things like that. And I got a phone call. I had published a piece in the New Yorker. Published a comic piece in the name. Shut up,
everyone.
All right, I published a comic piece in the New Yorker, and I had a phone call from a TV producer who said they wanted to adapt it for television. Would I be willing to do that? And I said, sure. And it was to be a program starring Anne Bancroft, who was a very successful Broadway and movie actress at the time. She was going to star in a program. She was married to a man named Mel Brooks, you may know. And I took this short story and adapted it as a sketch for television, and the show was, the program was very successful. I won an Emmy for writing it. And at the same time, I met the producer of the show, his name was Martin Charnin, and I met Mel Brooks. Became very important people in my life. Martin Charnin had been on Broadway as a young man. He was in the original cast of West Side Story. He was a theater person. He'd written three Broadway musicals. He'd written the lyrics for three Broadway musicals, all of which had folded out of town. But he wanted to do another musical, so he said to me, I think that you could write the book of a musical. And I said, I've never written one. I've been going to the theater ever since I was a kid. I love the musical theater. I love the theater. But I have no idea whether I could write a book of a musical or not. He said, well, if I have an idea, can I call you? I said, here's my phone number. Anytime, call me. About 6 months later, he called me and he said he had a very good idea for a musical. And I said, what is it? He said, the phone may be tapped. you have to come to my office and I'll tell you. So I went to his office and I said, well, what is this great idea? And he said, I want to do a musical of a comic strip, Little Orphan Annie. And I said, oh, no. I thought, I want to do West Side Story. I want to do My Fair Lady. I want to do something important, not a comic strip. And he said, well, I got Charles Strauss to write the music, a friend of mine. Charles Strauss. Charles, at that time, already had two Tonys and was like the hottest composer on Broadway. And I walked out and said, wait a second, it's these two guys who know Broadway. Who am I to tell them to get lost? So I said, let me think about it. What I did was I went to the New York Daily News where they had the back copies of Little Orphan Annie from the time it was first on in 1924 until the present, which then was 1971, too. And I looked at all those years of Little Orphan Annie and came back to them and I said, guys, there's nothing here. The only thing, the stories that don't make any sense, it's all ridiculous. There are three things. There's the richest man in the world, the poorest girl, and that dog. So I said, I'll try. As a college, particularly majoring in English literature, I read a lot of Dickens. And what was that? I read a lot of Dickens and I got thought, well, this is a Dickensian thing. This girl's an orphan. And Maybe I can cook up a story about her. Let's just come to Kenzie. So I invented this whole story of Annie the foundling and the half a locket left in her head and the disappeared parents and the bad lady who ran the orphanage and the mean brother who was a crook. And I've built up that whole story. All three of us, Martin, Charles, and I were all living in New York. They were born New Yorkers. I said, the comic strip wasn't set any place. It was set all over the place. So we said, well, make set it in New York. And then we thought, the other thing, all of us were kind of lefty-wing Democrats, and Nixon was president at the time. And we thought the country was in bad hands. We thought, why don't we write a musical that has politics in it and reflects a better time in American history. And we thought about the Depression and Franklin Roosevelt bringing America out of the Depression. So we decided to put that element in the story. So we set it in 1933. And that was the story we constructed. And the next thing you know, that was 1972. We did write it in 1972. The first two songs they wrote were one called Hard Knock Life and the other one called Tomorrow. And I said, wait a second, these guys know what they're doing. I know, these songs. So their Broadway connections, particularly Charles, we played the show for every producer in town and they all turned it down. The Schubert said, nah, a little girl and a dog, and let her go. So I was living up in Connecticut at the time. I remember taking all of my Annie stuff in a cardboard box and putting it up in the attic because that little adventure was over. And then 4 years later, in 1976, we got a phone call from Michael Price, who ran the Good Street Opera House. He'd heard it way back in 1972. And he said he was walking through a park in London and couldn't get this song out of his mind called Tomorrow. He said, maybe I should do that show, and that was the beginning. We did it at Good Street in the summer of 1976. We were on Broadway in 1977, and it took off. It's still flying.
The rest is, history, as we said.
Yeah.
Who in this room has ever been in Annie, been involved in Annie? I mean,
Oh, great. Yeah. Yeah.
So talking a little bit about your process and some of that, is your process different when you're adapting a musical as opposed to writing an original one? Where do you start in both places?
Well, my first thought is, a lot of people come to me with ideas. I mean, they came to me with Annie, and I thought it was a terrible idea. Other people have come to me with other terrible ideas. And I've turned down a lot of them. I have a feeling about, and maybe it's because of Annie, that what I'm looking for is a musical where there's a strong central character who has a dilemma. Someone you like, someone who maybe is in trouble in life and has a goal. And the most recent musical I had on Broadway was Rocky, which is a great example of that. Rocky was down and out. He was nowhere. He was a larger-than-life character, and he had something he desperately wanted. And the other element in a musical that I'm looking at is a love story of some sort, a really, really love story. And that was very true in Rocky. He had Adrian. In Annie, it turns out the love story is between a little girl and her father, her adopted father. In Hairspray, she's a total outsider, the overweight girl that nobody cares about, who has a dream and who eventually gets the best looking boy in her class, integrates television and all kinds of things. Hairspray is a very good example of something that has the perfect story for a musical as far as I'm concerned. The process of writing, if you take a movie, like when Mel Brooks and I did The Producers, the first thing to do is not to duplicate it. You have to rethink it. You have to reconstruct it. You have to take the movie apart. Movies have a totally different construction, so you have to start over in terms of the story. What I always do is study it and read it, and then write an outline, a new outline, where it's constructed in the same way the musical is, which is basically, it's a two-act. The people who are wiser than I am have told me, and I think I believe it, that if you construct your musical, there are four pillars you have to build. Your opening of Act One has to capture the audience. You have to introduce your lead character and make the audience like that character, care for what this character can win. The second pillar is the end of Act One, which is all very simple. You've got to then have a kind of cliffhanger moment where we don't know where the story's going to go, whether the hero or heroine is in some kind of real serious dilemma and trouble. And only Act Two is where you begin to bring you want to bring the audience back and have them have an upbeat moment, get the show going again with something bright, perhaps a dance number. And then obviously you've got to have a great finish. Like we had New Deal for Christmas and the Discovery that returns a dog and all happy ending. Hairspray, we have You Can't Stop the Beat, which is one of the great ending songs. Rocky, we've got the fight. That we know we have. Sometimes I think he should win. I was thinking maybe one night we make him win, the next night we won other shows.
Speaking of which, you've worked on a lot of musicals with large production elements, as we've been talking about. How does that function in your process? Do you feel like there are things about Rocky that you couldn't learn until the musical was on its feet as a book writer?
Probably, yeah. I think so. One of the important things that a book writer must understand that it's called a musical, and that is ultimately it's about the songs and the dances and the music, and the book writer plays a kind of secondary role to that. I mean, it's Rodgers and Hammerstein's show. It's not where we wrote the book of Hammerstein, but you know that it's the book writer is not the star. And so the book writer serves, and you often will write a scene and have some lines, and I say, well, that could be a song. And I say, please, go ahead. That's the process, that they will take some lines I wrote and make the song. Like in Annie, I had the idea where they had a scene with Rooster, the bad guy, and his girlfriend. I had doing some dialogue about how they're going to get this money to be on Easy Street. I used the phrase Easy Street. And then I said to him, maybe that's a song, too. And in fact, it did become a big successful song, you know, song and dance. And even then, after a while, as a book writer, you look for moments where it can dance, where it can move, where you can get a full cast on stage and do some big numbers. Oh, isn't this all boy and girl singing together? You create all kinds of ideas. You look at the story and find where is the music, where does it sing, and what possibly could be make it a musical. There are a lot of very good movies that I've been offered. People make one of the Stings of one. Others, they're terrific movies. I said no, because I don't see what he's singing. I see where you dance. I don't get it. I can't feel that. But you're always thinking as a book writer how it will sound, how it will look as a musical, because you're really taking something that's not necessarily musical and making it musical. So I'm not a musician. I don't write songs. I don't write lyrics. But I'm very, very happy when they hand me a song called Tomorrow, let's put that in the show. All I have to write is, gee, Sandy. Things are terrible, but No, maybe. If not today.
It's a very important line.
Yeah, I guess it is. It's pretty simplistic, but that's it, you know, it's part of what you do. It's not, and it's a, I love doing it, right? I wouldn't still be doing it in my dollar and old age. I'm still writing, I mean, two shows that are coming next year, probably. And I just keep on doing that, because when I tell my wife I'm going to work, I don't mean it, it's, I'm going out to have fun. Hanging out with people like Lennon C, Mel Brooks, and et cetera, old people I've been lucky enough to work with. They're so talented, and it's an adventure. You're going on a trip together.
You do have several collaborations just like that that have spanned many years, so I wanted to ask, what you feel like have been the key to long-term collaboration? Are you usually in the same room? You know, talking about Mel Brooks, who of course we know you've collaborated with many times, what are the keys that you found are successful there?
Well, I think that, you know, you're trying to do Skype and all kinds of things that you could do nowadays, you couldn't do that, but the fact is you do have to be in the room. It's great to be together in a room, preferably with a piano. A show that I did fairly recently was Elf, and all we had the director from the beginning, she don't really have, usually have, Casey Nicola, and we had songwriters, Chad and Matt, and we all met in my apartment where I had a piano. We wrote that whole show, they had a living room, and it would be, and it was an ideal sort of situation. They'd come over every day for 2 or 3 hours at my place, and that show was written much more quickly than any show I've ever done. We wrote it, and got it done in 3 months, really, and it was ready to go. And then there was money, the show got done. I've never had anything happen quite so fast as well. But I do think that you have to be together, and the idea that the book writer can go off, and I do write first drafts by myself, but I know that the first draft is going to be the first of 15 or 20 drafts, really. It's always, you're always revising. You never, I mean, you may get some scenes that stay the same, but there's so much rewriting done. There's so much happens from the day you go into rehearsal and the actors come, and the whole thing becomes something else. And the actors give you so much. If you get a naked lane, you can give them some lines, you're going to get some laughs. And the luck of having good actors, and the whole process. And then the next process, the people who really tell you whether you've got a good show or not is the audience. That's why I always believe you've got to go out of town and you've got to play somewhere and get reviews and get audiences. The people, you know, they have run-throughs and they invite 50 people into a studio, and that doesn't, they don't count. It's only people who pay money. If that audience laughs at a line, then it's funny. If you think this is the funniest line in the world, and that audience, three nights in a row, doesn't laugh, they're right, you're wrong. And you cut it, and you replace it, you do that. That audience is the last great collaborator on every show.
Speaking of out-of-town tryouts, I'm really curious about this. What do you think are the main ways that being a librettist has changed in the years since you've started out? I guess in general, being a librettist and the musical in general.
Well, I mean, there are all kinds of, I'm really a traditional kind of musical guy when I talk about the four main things. That probably is not what you're going to get in Fun Home or something like that. Fun Home, I'm a Tony voter, and I voted for it for Best Musical. I admire it a lot. I think it's a very beautiful, serious piece of work. It's, in my mind, it's more of a play with music than a musical. But there's room for things that are not the kind of musical I'm talking about, kind of offbeat musicals that really touch the heart. I mean, the love story in Fun Home is between little girl and her father, and so is Annie, come to think of it, but it's not, it becomes different to say the may have changed, but the big successful musicals, it's still, the book writers are still the same. It hasn't changed that much. The craft of book writing is still the same. It's making it into a musical, taking something that was not a musical and musicalizing it. And the lyricist, the composer, to a large degree, directors, to a lot of the people who make it a musical. The book, that first outline I do, which is usually about 30 pages, can be sort of a Bible that we use to get us going and keep going.
I'm curious to ask from that, you know, out of the traditional musicals, not Fun Home, but the, you know, structured as we've been talking about, are there librettos that you admire that are from musicals that you've seen as an audience member?
Well, the librettos I admire most are Gypsy, which Martha Lawrence wrote. It's like a model of the great book. Martha Lawrence was a successful off-Broadway and Broadway playwright. Real playwright. I'm not really a playwright. I don't think, you know, well, every once in a while I start to work on a play and I give up. But the structure of a Gypsy is a model, and there's smothers it. I'm trying to think, I mean, almost all the classic musicals, all of, like, you know, The King and I, which is just sort of incredible production here. Center. It's such a beautiful book, so well done, Oscar has on. The structure is perfect. You have this woman who's a widow and alone in the world and comes to this strange place. She's looking for some kind of love, some place in the world. This exotic Siam, the king who turns out to be the man, she comes and falls in love with him, falls in love with her, even though it's not that kind of relationship. It's a beautiful thing when they said, shall we dance at the end? It's gorgeous musical. So well constructed. The music is so great. Those Oscar Einstein books are all good. West Side Story, that was also Arthur Lawrence, who wrote the book. It's another great book. But it was stolen from Shakespeare. I thought you could do that too.
Can you tell us a little bit about what you're working on now?
I have two musicals. One is based on a movie called Dave that was with Kevin Kline, a man who looked exactly like the President of the United States. And I was attracted to that because this is a kind of loser guy. With a heart of gold, who's an innocent, who's caught up into a very rough world, corrupt world of Washington politics. And he's a good person, and the only other good person is the president's wife. And there's a terrific love story in this. So it's a kind of love story that's set in Washington. And the movie was done in 1992, but we've done it sort of taking place in what I call a fictional present. It's now, supposedly, that there's an election going on, and it's been, we have it as the main president has just been reelected and then has an affair with the secretary and has a stroke, and our man who's hired only to impersonate the president for public occasions, so he becomes president of the United States. It's a terrific story, and I think it's exciting, and we're working on it. And I have Tom Kidd, who won the Pulitzer Prize for musical, and Nell Benson writing the book. And we're looking for a director, but I think we have Tina Landau probably going to do it. And it's very exciting, it's for next year. And it was Maury Yeston, I've written a musical based on an old Preston Sturges movie from 1941, it's called The Lady Eve. Yeah, and that is a old-fashioned musical comedy. A romantic comedy was made into a musical comedy. We Lori and I had done Death Takes a Holiday together, which was kind of Debbie Downer. we wanted to do something fun and old fashioned. We said, let's do a kind of 30s Cole Porter musical. So we looked at a lot of movies and we found this movie, which is kind of classic, people know it. But Lady Eve is Barbara Stanwyck and Henry Fonda. Henry Fonda is the richest young bachelor in the world and a goofy guy whose main being in life is to go into the Amazon jungle and find poisonous snakes and collect snakes. And he then meets this lovely girl, Barbara Stanwyck, on a cruise ship. He's coming back from the Amazon with the snakes. And she seems like the perfect, he's finally met a girl he loved her. She, however, is a part of a family of card sharks and they're out to take him for all his money. So it's a terrific, funny, charming movie. And we've written this musical, so it's moving slowly forward. So it could be next year or the year after. It's, we're actually casting right now for a reading in September. So those are the two. As it turns out, when you have a lot of musicals, you also have a lot of, I mean, it's a great thing to have, it's sort of upkeep. We have to go to Germany to move Rocky from Hamburg to Stuttgart. And so I have to be in Germany in the fall, and then Elf is only in London in November, so we're going to be involved in that. And then I'm working with Mel Brooks on a revised version of Young Frankenstein, which is probably going to be in London next winter. And slightly smaller production at the moment on Broadway. Young Frankenstein was not a big success on Broadway, but it was a pretty good show. I think we've found a way to cut about 20 minutes out of it and make it pace better and funnier, maybe.
I was reading some interviews this week that you've given previously, and I just read something about your continued work on musicals where you said, I could move to Florida and play golf, but I hate Florida and I don't like golf.
That's me.
So sad. I think I have one more quick question, and then we're going to do some presentations and then some questions from you guys. I just wanted to jump back quickly and ask, what was it like the first kind of coming up with the idea for the producers? How did that project become what that project became?
Well, I worked with Mel on a couple of movies, Spaceballs and To Be or Not to Be. And then we didn't see each other very much for quite a while. I decided I didn't like to work out in California that much. And he likes California. And it came up that some company wanted to do an animated version of Spaceballs. So I flew out to California to meet with Mel to discuss whether or not we would do an animated version of Spaceballs. And we had a lot of talks about this, and we said, let's not do an animated version. And he said, I have this other idea that David Geffen wants me to do, Mel said. He said we should do a movie of a musical of the producers. And he said, would you be interested in working on it with me? And I said, yes. Because I love working with Mel, and I didn't think that the producers had the elements of what I talked about. It's a story of somebody who's really down and out, Max Bialystock, who's struggling to make his way in the back in the world and get a hit show on Broadway. And the great plot idea that they have to raise money and get put on the biggest flop in history is a great twist. And then the other thing is that the relationship between the two men is really what is known now as a bromance. It's a love story. The song made in the show called Tell Him is kind of a real love story song. And I could see that in all the elements. I was very upset. I was very negative about the fact that there was not a lot of 60s stuff in the movie, and not a lot of hippie and stuff like that. I said, let's not put it in the 60s, let's put it back in the 50s, which Mel finally agreed to. and retains some of the characters. We reconstructed it. The movie is a terrific movie, but it's a kind of cult movie. It made it for $1 million and it never earned back the million. So, but it was a well-known movie. And it was hard, particularly in the movie, it was Zero Mostel, it was so sensational, but we got to Nathan Lane, who was even more sensational. It was a terrific trip. We loved working on it together, and we had a lot of help. There was a guy named Glenn Kelly who helped to write all the songs, lyrics. Susan Stroman, who did a brilliant job of choreographing and directing. This was, and Robin Wagner set. It was one of the things where once in a while it all comes together. Everybody's good, everybody gets along. We're laughing all the way through. And we went to Chicago with it and went down the house, broke records. It just was like, you couldn't stop it. That happens once in a while. Sometimes, that way you love a show, you work very hard on it, you're with good people, and it doesn't make it, you know. So it's mysterious. Sometimes, why didn't it happen? It didn't.
I'm just going to take attendance real quick, and then we'll hear from a couple of the groups. So group one is Mark, Peter, and Leah. Are you guys here?
Yeah.
Excellent. Group two is Talara?
Talara,
thanks. Yeah. And Diane?
Diane.
Yes, Diane. Jim, Nathan, Heather.
Tom.
Good. Group three. Group four is Sophie, Kamala, Sylvia. Excellent. Group five, Harriet, Eric, Anna. Perfect. Group six, Patrick, Philip, Darby, Patrick.
Okay.
Group seven is Kit, Caleb, Gil. Yep. Group eight, Erica, Jonathan, Ali, Danielle. Perfect. Group nine, Andrew, Julia, Christopher. Okay. Is that the same? Okay. Group 10 is Nadev and Bart. Excellent. Perfect. Okay, good. Okay, so. The first group to go is group three, Nathan, Jim, and Heather. And you guys want to perform down there, or what do you think is best?
Whatever you prefer.
Whatever you guys are comfortable doing.
Would you guys rather work down here, or would you rather do it up front and then?
Should we have the mics?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. And let me know if you don't want me to tape your scene. I will otherwise tape it. Are you guys good with taping?
Hi, this is a very rough draft of the first few minutes of No Chance in Hell. And I'm Heather, I wrote the book, and that's Jim, he wrote the lyrics, and Natan, who wrote the music. Dreamlike yet sinister music. 2:58 a.m., a dark and stormy Friday morning. A grim office cubicle dominated by a large wall clock. A man in a cheap suit, Frank Oster, CPA, is sleeping at his desk.
Frank Oster. Frank Oster. Frank!
A peal of thunder. Frank jolts awake.
Is there someone there? Oh, God.
Not God, but close.
Frank tries to find the source of the sound, but nobody's there.
Someone must be hearing things. Come on, Frank, pull yourself together.
He looks at the clock, his hand hovers over the keyboard, he looks back at the clock.
It's 2:58, and I have to wait till 3. There's 500 grand I'll have in my hand at 3. When the server goes down and starts to reboot, when it re-enters the company's loop, there'll be 500 free when I unlock it, debit their assets and credit my pocket. All of this will come to be at 3. I'm not cut out for committing grand larceny. as one can tell from my autobiography. I was born the fifth child of Melanie Auster. She gave me so little, I aspired to be poor. When asked how many children she had, she always answered, four. All I had or wore were hand-me-downs, but she always dressed to a T. As I contemplate felony, I remembered dear Melanie, who never remembered me. When I came to this food chain, a CPA, I was up to my eyebrows in hock and out of cash. After day of long hours and little pay, it came to me like a shock and then a flash. There's no chance in hell I'd live large on milk and honey if I keep counting beans and other people's money. I've never done anything wrong, but now I'm singing a different song. What makes grand larceny grand? When your caper on paper goes down as planned, or the cachet that comes with cash in hand? I want to know. I gotta know. Stop. It's almost three. Okay, Frank, it's time for a choice. Disappear or find your voice. Now for once you're thinking bigger. Come on, Frank, pull the trigger. Okay.
He reads from a paper.
I press delete.
Looks at the audience.
And two keys I won't tell. And I won't get caught because there's no chance in hell.
Blinding flash of lightning. The office disappears, replaced by a wonderland of neon lights.
Frank Auster, come on down. You've been chosen to play No Chance in Hell.
What the hell?
That's No Chance in Hell, Frank. America's favorite game show. No Chance in Hell, the pop-up show. It's here when you come and gone when you go.
But how?
Yes, it's No Chance in Hell, that popular game show. You have no chance in hell of beating the game, or do you? We'll find out today on No Chance in Hell. We posted an ad, and lemmings like you came. So welcome. I'll tell you the rules of the game.
This is all a bad dream, right? I'll pinch myself, I'll wake up. Ah! I'm still here.
Miss Fortune, why don't you escort Frank here to his grisly, his terminal, please.
Miss Fortune, a glamorous assistant with a Stepford wife smile, appears. She grabs Frank's elbow and starts to drag him to the terminal. Frank
no,
struggles.
No, please, I have to.
Miss
you have
Fortune
to,
drags him to the terminal.
You have to what, Frank? Push a button?
How do you know?
I know everything, Frank. Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for Frank Auster, an accountant from Flushing, and my assistant, the lovely Miss Fortune.
Miss
Fortune.
Totally
not a pun.
Smiles blankly.
Isn't she something? Let's explain the games for our viewers, shall we? Three contestants, are chosen from everyday, ordinary people, folks just like you. Frank, about to push the button on their humdrum boring lives and try to beat the game. But can they? Can anyone ever beat the game? We'll find out today on, say it with me everybody, No Chance in Hell. We got audience participation going.
I don't understand.
The FTC obliges me to tell you how it all works. Yada yada, you bet money, you lose money, you always lose money. Please do not play No Chance in Hell without the advising of a priest or minister. Side effects may include heartache, headache, soul ache, or death.
Huh?
But don't ask a lady luck to stay up late, since there's no chance in hell. It must be fate. Let's meet our suckers, contestants, shall we?
Miss Fortune waves her arms, revealing the other contestants.
Margaret Sibel from Apple Tree, Ohio, who wears a hat.
Margaret, a pretty yet very insecure woman, smiles nervously.
And what do you do, Margaret?
Pass!
Whoa, hold on there, partner. The game hasn't started yet. We're just getting to know you up playing over there. We're gonna cut that line, right? King and I might be playing. We're live. Okay, we're live, apparently. All right. We're just getting to know you. Miss Fortune tells me you are a jewelry store manager.
Pass. I mean, yes. I mean, no. I don't know. I mean, like Frank said, Mr. MC, I don't know why I'm here. I was in my bed 1 minute, not able to sleep, worried how I'm going to pay my rent this month, when all of a sudden I'm hearing, pass! That's what my friend Ethel Baumgartner said, to say whenever you're on a game show and you don't know the answer, pass. It's the safest way to go, so you don't lose it all.
You've lost a lot on your way here, haven't you then, Margaret?
I lost my job, Mr. MC, the jewelry store. It's not doing so well, so they cut back on employees. And then I was sad all the time, so I got into arguments with my boyfriend, Mike, a lot. So he left.
Frank Gloucester does not wear a hat.
What a loser, to leave someone as nice and pretty as you.
Margaret Seabell wears a hat.
Thanks. I guess you're nice, Mr. Call me Frank.
A moment, they stare at each other.
To make things worse, Mike took Toodles, that's my cat. Sometimes I wonder, why can't I just catch a break? I want to be lucky just for once in my life. I want to be the person with the cool job, the cute boyfriend, and the cool cat. Okay, right now I just settle for the cat, to be honest.
Is that why you're planning to rob the jewelry store so you can buy yourself a new cat?
Pass.
That's a lot of kitty litter, Margaret. Moving on to contestant number two. It's Valerie Anton from Shallow Falls, North Dakota.
Miss Fortune waves her arms to reveal Valerie. How did I get here? I was backstage waiting to go on for a gig, and then I'm here.
Miss Fortune tells me you're a, what is it, YouTube something star, Valerie? Kids today. Kids and their technology. Why are you here today?
I'm a singer songwriter, Mr. MC. I write what people might call indie music, though I don't like labels. They're so labeling, you know? To get myself out there, I made my own YouTube channel. My friend Sam records my gigs, and then we make our own videos, and well, I have nearly 1 million followers, but I want more. Even more than my rival, Tina JKB, who's got like 2 million. Some people say I should be more rock and roll like Tina, but hey, maybe exposure on this game should help, you know? I guess that's why I'm here.
Is that why you plan on hacking Tina and GKB's YouTube channel, don't you? Good luck with that, Valerie. Now, number three, Mr. Frank Oster, who does not wear a hat. Why are you here, Frank, to beat the game?
Well, I...
Great, now let's play. Say it with me, everybody. No chance in hell. Margaret, you won the coin toss backstage. We use three-sided coins here.
I did?
You go first.
I won something? That doesn't sound like...
How much do you bet?
Pass.
Valerie, the question goes to you. What do you wager?
I don't know. I never saw this game before. Miss Fortune whispers into the MC's ear.
Miss Fortune suggests $5,000.
I'm okay.
For $5,000, what is your favorite food?
Oh, wow. I wasn't expecting a personal question. My favorite food is deviled eggs.
Right!
Miss Fortune holds up an applause sign and smiles vacantly.
Frank, how much do you bet on your question? 500K? That's just a drop in the bucket for those bastards.
What?
For 500K. You're betting 500K now.
Seriously?
What is your favorite dessert?
Seriously?
I never kid.
This is like taking candy from a baby. Okay, Mr. MC, my favorite dessert is devil's food cake.
That's 500K for you, Frank.
Miss Fortune holds up a claw sign and smiles vacantly.
Maybe this is a sign. Maybe it will all work out. I won't get caught. I mean, this game is easy, right? It's such a simple algorithm. It's easy to beat. And if I can win this, I can steal the 500,000 and they'll never notice.
That's the end of our excerpt for now.
So why don't you guys move over here and then we'll let Tom and Jennifer go up.
Where do you go from here? With the music? With the story.
The game show gets increasingly stranger, and the rules change. Even though he'll establish a rule, or appear to establish a rule, but then it will change immediately. And it ends up in the final round. It's just Frank and the MC, and we haven't figured out how to do this yet. But Frank will try to give up his soul in exchange for Margaret.
We're sort of reinterpreting Faust.
Loosely, yes.
Basically, a love story develops between Margaret, the hapless one who passes, and Frank, and he, who's going to be able to get through this intact, gives his soul up. But he tricks the devil, as always happens in this case, and we won't tell you how.
And it's all a dream at the end, and he's back in the office in the cubicle. And
or is it a dream?
Or is it a dream? We don't know. And his, yeah.
And then and Margaret comes in, he turns out he did not press the button when he fell asleep. He makes the decision in favor of Wright instead of selling his soul. That's the way it works out.
It sounds promising. I guess
one question we had was with the framing device of the dream, are we like, you know, dragging you through hell? literally, like, are we, you know, taking too long to start and cut into the chase?
Potentially, we could open directly on the game itself and let the characters sort of fill in the backstory as the game goes on.
Well, there's a little mystery in the way you start now. We don't know what's going to happen. I think where you start is okay. And then you explode into the game show. So it's like almost a little prologue. It's just okay.
Are the songs boring with so much exposition in them?
Not really. I was charmed by it. I was swinging. But I think I'll pursue it.
Okay, well, let's thank group three.
Thank you.
The next group is Bart, Dov. And are you guys okay with being filmed?
We still haven't come up with a title. Oh, it's out of battery. We still haven't come up with a title for this, but this is our 20-minute musical comedy, and I'm Bart Greenberg. I write the book.
I'm Britt. I write the music.
Britt.
And there's.
I'm the Dove.
Who also was writing the music in it?
Yeah.
And we're reading, it's almost the opening scene, it's a short scene before this. The setup is that Honeydew Jackson has arrived in New York City from Tennessee, determined to be part of the high life that she's seen on TV of New York City. She's managed to get an appointment for, or an interview for a job with the richest woman on Park Avenue. And as the scene, I'll be reading Nathan, who is Madame, the richest woman's assistant. Britt is reading Honeydew, and Nadav is actually reading Madame. And we're gonna have a little imagination there. And at the start of the scene, Honeydew has just stepped up the elevator into Madame's very lavish apartment, which is 5 stories high in the apartment building.
We would love this to ultimately be a scene and song, and so we'd love, if you got it, input on what the song would be, where it would go, and that sort of thing, in addition to any other content input you have.
Miss Jackson.
Howdy!
I am Nathan Vanderhampton, Madame's nephew and her business manager.
Oh, it's real nice to meet you. I think it's real sweet when kinfolk employ a person for us. I'm sure you'd do a good job anyway, even if it is a case of nephewism.
I believe you mean nepotism, but I assure you I'm highly qualified for my job. I have an MBA from Wharton.
Oh, mister, I wasn't implying that you weren't worthy. It's just I've been having such a tough time even getting an interview. I've been living in New York City for a whole month answering ad after ad, and this here one is the first I even got a response from. I am sure grateful to Madame for seeing me.
Actually, it was I who chose your resume.
Oh, well, thank you, Mr. Nathan.
And Nathan will do. And yes, I believe I was very right. You'll be perfect to serve as Queen Nefertiti's do for?
Who's what?
Madame will explain, if you'll wait here.
Can I sit down on this couch?
When it comes from IKEA, it's a couch. That is an original Corbusier. It's a divan.
If Mr. Corbusier doesn't mind, I'll just go and settle in.
Yes, you'll be perfect. Exactly what I was hoping for.
Perfect, the man said. I'm perfect. A whoopee!
Madame, this is...
No. Don't tell me. Let me see. Daphne, darling, your name is Daphne. Madame.
Madame, my name is...
Daphne.
Madame, here's my resume.
Never mind that. I never worry about resumes.
The scene shifts to Madame's elegant Victorian receiving room. Madame leads Honeydew into the room.
Subsume yourself, my dear.
Pardon me, Madame?
Subsume yourself.
Oh, yes, Madame, I shall subsume myself onto this divan.
So, you wish to be Queen Nefertiti's Dufour?
Do I?
Perhaps I should translate.
Translate? There's no need to translate, my dear Daphne. I use words as they should sound, what they are at the core of their being. I'm not limited by the small minds of others' vocabulary. Queen Nefertiti is my snuggle fluff. My feline companion.
Oh, you're a cat!
Cat! A ridiculous word. Never use it again in my presence.
But, madame, you said another word I didn't quite catch. Do for?
Oh, my, you do have a quick ear. Very, very good. I do not like the term. What is it, Egglethorpe?
Personal assistant.
I thought your name was...
Madame prefers to think of me as Egglethorpe.
Well, it does kind of suit you.
Exactly. Now, let us see if you're qualified to be my snuggle fluff Dufour.
I promise you I'll be the best snuggle fluff Dufour.
Many say that. You succeed. The last several Dufours I've employed have been most disappointing. Things have happened, unfortunate things. First of all, in order to work and live in my household, one must be willing to live as I do, view the world as I do, express themselves as I do. When I was a young woman, even younger than you, sweet child, I realized the world was a drab, drab place. People's homes were drab. People's thoughts were drab. The English language is drab, 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 drab. And I decided to do something about it, to add some color, to add some imagination, to add some fun. Why must we leave things exactly as they are? Why must we call things like everyone else calls them? And you, my dear Daphne, share my spirit. You've come to New York City to reinvent yourself, to become you. Welcome to my imaginarium.
Madame, you are just so inspiring.
Thank you, my dear. Now, in 1 week, my dear Queen Nefertiti will obtain the grand age of 20 and obtain her immortality as the goddess Nefertiti and a lovely share of affluvish all her own. I shall jubilate the event with levitation in my Egyptian ensemblage.
You're given a party to celebrate and you're gonna dress up like Cleopatra?
What? Oh, no. My ensemblage is what some refer to as the rooms or apartments. You will find each of the floors of my home are designed and decorated as one, an ensemblage.
Madame, that just makes so much sense.
Doesn't it?
Please teach me more, I wanna learn it all.
You must make sure that the queen is always happy, well-fed, well-groomed, and her catikins and bouncibles are always nearby.
Her bouncible and...
Catikins. It's a little soft-shaped snuggle fluff she loves to chew on. She must have her toys. You must make sure she never loses them.
Yes, madame.
You must always keep her safe. Absolutely nothing can be allowed to harm my snuggle fluff. Nothing.
I'll protect her with my life, madame.
You must always keep her away from the flumables. She is fascinated by flumables for some reason.
Flumables, madame?
Flumables. Oh, dear. Perhaps I was wrong about you.
Oh, no, please. Give me a moment, please. Just give me
me a clue, just a little clue, please.
There are 7 flumables in my ensemblages, both stone and brick.
Flumables, a fireplace?
Yes.
Yay for me!
Yay for you indeed. Tell me, Daphne, can you move in immediately to assume your duties?
Oh yes, madame, right away, thank you so much!
I do hope you will last longer than the last 3 Dufours. They all disappointed me greatly.
Oh, let me see, let me see. Fireplace is a flumable, a cat is a snuggle fluff, and the caretaker is a Dufour. Toys are bounceable and a catikins, and assemblage is a decorated room. Levitation is a big party. Jubilate is to celebrate. Subsume is to sit down. Well, I'm gonna subsume myself and jubilate in my new position as the number one snuggle fluff Dufour in charge of bouncables and catikins. Hooray!
I was thinking that this is easy. I can see the visualization that we should know her backstory.
She actually does have a song in the first scene.
Right, she does. All right. So maybe we know that. Then obviously there's a big song for Bada,
mm-hmm.
about her whole philosophy. That's the big point of the scene. That's your kind of big you're going to say this. You could, in a bigger musical, bring out another service so that it becomes more than just a solo. It could be dance, everything. It's sitting there to be musicalized. But the dialogue is very witty. It's smart stuff. Go for it.
It's great. Yeah. Thank you.
I'm just curious, so you said, how long is the musical?
20 minutes.
Is it 20 minutes? So is this like scene 2?
Yes.
Cool. And where does it go after this?
Yeah.
Well, it turns out Nathan is a diehard villain trying to kill off Queen Nefert Kitty because he figures if he gets rid of the cat, he's going to get the money that was going to the cat.
Right.
And so, of course, Honeydew has to foil his plans. At the big party.
Mm-hmm.
And of course she will CC.
The new words stand in her way because she tries to explain the situation, but
yeah.
Then
this snuggle fluff is stuck in the flammable.
And everybody's like, hmm?
So
she finds out that actually sometimes the straightforward words are the best.
And does Madame kick the bucket?
No, Madame doesn't. The cat survives.
Because
Madame.
Because usually the cat ends up with everything.
No. In this case, Nathan gets fired and Honeydew gets his job.
You're very mean to the cat. She may or may not be burned, shaved,
plucked.
Lots of merch opportunities.
All musicals are kind of, fairy tales.
Right.
And the fact is that she could end up, Honeydew could end up with the cat and the money. If all the money was left to the cat. That's going maybe too far, but.
Well, we were kind of thinking more that the central relationship between Madame and Honeydew.
Yeah.
That it almost becomes
like
a mother-daughter.
Yeah.
Relationship.
Yeah. The Honeydew has to be a winner.
Oh, yes.
All right, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Mark Eugene Garcia.
I know you just read, but can we read it here?
Sure.
It's very cool. Hi. And I have some copies. My name is Mark. For our show, let me believe it while I'm talking. For our show, we have a three-person show. It's a small musical. It all takes place in one living room. Where we started was that Dan has come over because his best friend Ellie has called him over for an emergency. And the beginning of this has been back and forth of revealing of small secrets while Dan is trying to get Ellie to confess why exactly she called him over. He has just told her, she got him to admit that years ago he wrote a series of love letters to somebody to let them down easily and as somebody else. And so just now, she's finally going to tell him what the big emergency is. And this is Ellie, and I'm Dan.
It's about April.
What about her?
After her breakup, she's been in this rut. It's almost a year, and she always calls me crying, complaining about the lack of good guys in the world, so I made up a guy. I know, it's awful. I told her I have this friend, Philip. So when I described him, I described basically her perfect date. So when she said she wanted to meet him, I lied and said he lived in Iowa.
Iowa?
Yeah, I don't know where that came from either, but when she said she wanted to call him, I said she could text him. And I got this new phone.
You got a new phone that texts her? Are you crazy?
She was hurting.
This will appear on your credit card.
No, it's prepaid, and I used a Visa gift card to get the American Express gift card I used to get the prepaid phone.
Ooh. You've really thought this out.
Of course I did, but that's not the point. The point is that I've been doing this for a while.
How long is a while?
6 months, and it's getting out of control.
Now it's getting out of control. Now? On the phone you said you did something, it was something really bad. I thought it meant you, I don't know, it killed somebody.
Killed somebody?
I have a shovel and a tarp in my car. I was going to the desert. I thought we'd be burying a body tonight.
Why would you even think that? Who would I kill?
I don't know. I just thought that, you know, Ellie doesn't do bad things. I figured if you said it was bad, then it must be really, really bad.
You brought a shovel? You would bury a body for me?
The point is, I thought a lot of things, but I did not see this coming.
And there is something else. I was texting April as Philip, and she sent this.
Oh my god.
Yep.
But what was she? In her bathtub.
Yep.
And she's certainly flexible.
Yep.
And it looks like she's about to
scroll to the next picture.
Whoa! Dan. There she goes. How did she get at that angle?
It doesn't matter how she did it, Dan. What matters is that I'm in trouble. She wants a picture. So she got into a bathtub full of bubbles, then contortion yoga her ankles to her ears and started sexting me while she waits for her imaginary boyfriend to get it up. Now, how the hell am I supposed to do that? It's not funny.
You have to admit, it's kind of hilarious.
No, it's not funny. I need your help.
I mean, what the hell am I supposed to do?
The phone has a camera, Dan.
What are you saying?
No one has to see your face.
Oh, no. No, 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 no.
You were ready to help me bury a body. This should be killed.
No!
Just step into the bathroom. It should only take a minute.
Wait, how do you know how long it'll take?
What would a real friend say?
You're out of your fucking mind. Are you out of your mind?
Dan, please. I figured if anyone would understand me, it would be you. You once wrote those love notes to Vicky Landman. You carried it on for weeks. And you know what this is like.
I loved her.
Please, Dan. I'm begging you, please.
Oh my god. You love her. That's why you did all this. Yeah, why didn't I see this? All this time that I've been waiting here, you've loved April.
I'm sorry, Dan. I didn't want to hurt you, but I can't lose her.
Okay. Give me the phone.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Dan.
There's a song that happens very early on in the scene where Ellie is describing her setting up her setup with April, and that we bring in April. So she, as she's telling the story, April, she's living the scene with April on the side, and April has a song where she's basically talking about her rut. So we get that in the top of. So that's one of the songs that we've already conceived and worked on.
We have a lot of the preparation, the steps it takes to create to get the prepaid card, to get the second prepaid card, to get the phone. A lot of the franticness of all of those very, very desperate steps. But in her head, they're so logical.
Yeah, well, that's a terrific
logic. I felt that way. I looked up like catfishing and so, which is where the show came from, and it's just that people do these things, and they don't do it for fun. Like there is a strange logic to it.
Yeah. Did she read a cold reading?
Yeah, that was a cold reading. She's great.
Thank you. Well done, yeah.
Yeah.
Pursue that.
Thank you very much.
It's
a, I hate to use
the word charming. It's charming and
fun.
Thank you.
Awesome, thanks so much.
Erica, Jonathan.
So this is Moving On, a one-act sort of musical comedy. It's about a young couple named Nate and Kristen. They're in their 20s, and they're finally making the commitment to move in together into a two-bedroom apartment on the Upper East Side. And naturally, a lot of big life questions are sort of a 20-minute snapshot of that moment when you first move in, but then all of a sudden, a lot of major life decisions come into question, and it's this idea of, can you truly grow up and still be a kid, for lack of a better term. There are specific plot twists and turns and major commitments that happen, and again, this is all in the span of 20 minutes of real time. So without further ado, moving on. Act 1, early morning, 7 a.m. on a Friday, late summer, NYC, the Upper East Side, an apartment with some unopened boxes. Kristen and Nate open the door and barge in with overstuffed duffel bags, bagels, coffee, and a box of wine in tow. And this is basically the big exuberant opening number where they set up how free of restrictions they are. There are no strings. They finally signed all the documents, and they're finally going to make a home. But maybe there are a few things that are left to discuss.
Can we unpack the wine glasses first?
Oh, let me lie down.
And lo, 832 East 90th Street would be changed forever. The gods smiled upon Kristen and granted her rest, for this is indeed a great day of firsts. Our first apartment together, followed by the first time you didn't have enough energy to do kettlebells.
Thank God we're not going to the meatball garden until 7. Kristen nearly faints, but Nate catches her.
At your service.
You don't need to.
And that's why you are an independent woman who needs her space. Speaking of, what the hell are we gonna do with that extra bedroom?
Hey, I love how our parents aren't around. Although we can say hell. Shit, our parents aren't around. I can fart.
Who doesn't fart in front of their... I mean, I was thinking...
What, an office?
Maybe. When I get settled in.
Assuming all goes well with Jacoby and Martinez Esquires, we could buy this place a few years down the line.
You'd have to thank the firm, not me.
Stop being so hard on yourself, boo. That second bedroom would look nice with some wallpaper.
Carpeting.
Soundproofing.
And of course,
kittens. They kiss.
Only the classiest boudoir for my lady.
Aw, boo.
And then comes a song with the tentative title, The Christening. It's an active song where they start to have sex, and throughout the song, notice the various quirks of the apartment. Spoken interlude over music.
Let's role play. You be an all-powerful sex goddess, and I'll be a responsible adult.
I'm so freaking turned on by that, you have no idea.
Flourish and a sexy twirly dance move. Song continues. Spoken interlude 2.
Where's our blanket?
Oh, no, we don't need it.
We're not bumping uglies on a dirty floor, and God knows we're not using that closet.
Let's just use the wall.
You know which blanket I'm talking about, right? The neon pink?
Yeah, that one's all janky.
Song continues. Spoken interlude 3. We hear glass marbles scattering a beat.
Were those marbles? Ghost marbles?
Look, I know what you mean about the soundproofing. I'm not stupid.
Oh, that's amazing.
It's your dream. You want to open a Pilates studio for kids? Everyone's got to start somewhere.
Yeah. You really know me too well.
I know you're up for almost everything, but don't forget to stick the landing.
Song continues. The phone rings.
Shit. Time Warner. You take it.
You know, it took us 8 months to fix the computer because I was in charge.
Just pick up.
Okay.
Nate takes the phone out of his pocket.
This is Nate. Yeah. As soon as possible. What time do we want? What day and time?
June 30th between 10 and 2.
June 30th between 10 and 2. Suggesting we wait till August.
We need Game of Thrones! Spoilers! HBO Go! Dothraki!
I think we're smart enough to read books until then.
You work at a law firm. Negotiate.
I'm a file clerk.
This move doesn't have to be as sweaty and cortisol-ridden as it could be.
Look, what's cortisol?
Stress hormones.
Look, we've fallen on really hard times.
Don't say that, be polite.
What I mean is...
And then we have a song about the arduous process of arguing with Time Warner about when to install the cable, what's going to happen, how to avoid all the mishaps, and trust me, Jonathan and Danielle, who is on vacation, they're going to write an amazing song about this. That's our excerpt.
Well, not hearing the song right, I'm not quite sure how it's going to go. It feels sort of first drafty to me. You really got to get back to it. I like the premise. I think it's good. I think that it feels like it feels too surfacey. I don't feel it's three dimensional as I'd like to feel. But maybe the songs are what I'm missing. It's not ready for prime time. I would stop. I think the idea is good. I'm going to go for it. But rethink a little bit. Is this sort of, what is it, sort of on the nose, I feel like I'm not surprised. That's what it is. The more you can make it crazier, the more it's pretty crazy, but make it even crazier.
Any questions?
Not at the moment, thank you.
All right, thank you. Okay, we have one more.
You want me to read Mule?
Yes, I want you to read
Mule. You heard me!
It's a part I know. Direct me around like a mule.
Hi, I'm Talara. I'm book and lyrics, and this is Diane, and she's composing our musical called Slaw Slingers, which is, it's a western set in a prairie town about dueling coleslaw stands in the town square. So, come on, you wrote Spaceballs. So, stage directions, Josie, Mule, and Kit Cabbage.
Josie Kale.
Oh, wait. Oh, I should tell you where we are. I'm so sorry. This is about scene 3. We've had an opening introduction to the little town square and to Kit Cabbage and her coleslaw stand called the Slaw Stall. And then we've had sort of her her I Want song, which is called 817, because she wants to be on that 817 coach out of town. And then this happens.
Josie Pale enters wheeling a food cart. She stops in the corner opposite the slaw stall and raises her awning. She attaches a sign that reads, "The Outslaw, Josie Kale."
Oh. Who the hell are you?
Josie Kale leans against her stall and points at the sign.
Kale?
It's a dark leafy green.
I know what kale is. You don't make slaw with it.
Well, I do.
That's not slaw, that's a salad.
Kale is considered to be closer to wild cabbage than most domesticated forms of vegetables.
Mule, what's going on here?
She filed the paperwork, kid.
So that's it? She files a piece of paper and is granted rights by the almighty head of state to destroy my livelihood?
You afraid of a little competition?
There's no need for two slaw stands in the same damn town!
One of us will have to go, then.
Well, ain't gonna be me. This is my town.
Take it easy, kid.
Looks like this town could use a little shaking up anyhow. I bet folks get tired of cabbage and cornbread. What do you say, Mule?
Mule loves cornbread.
I can speak for myself. I love cornbread.
And coleslaw?
Yeah, and coleslaw.
Made from cabbage.
You prairie folk are all alike.
What?
The same.
I know what alike means.
You get trapped in your wide open space. The land is too flat and the sky is too big. You look out and you can't see anything different. Just same, same, same.
We're comfortable.
Truth be told, I never even heard of kale.
Good thing I rolled into town then, huh?
You can't come in here with your fancy slaw and your big ideas and your definitions and try to change people.
I'm not trying to change anyone. I'm giving them options.
They're never gonna like it, you'll see.
Maybe you should let them make up their own minds. What do you say, Mule?
Couldn't hurt.
Don't do this to me, Mule.
It's just slaw, kid.
It's not just slaw. It's our way of life, and she's insulting it.
I haven't said one bad thing about it. I like cornbread, too, but there's something to be said for naan.
What? I actually don't know what that means.
Oven-baked flatbread found in the cuisines of West, Central, and South Asia.
Well, huh.
Josie serves Mule a carton of kale slaw. Kit slaps it out of his hand.
We don't want your kind here!
And then there's a song that starts.
Read the first four lyrics.
This town ain't big enough. Hey there, old-timer. Why all the fuss? The square's got four corners and there's only two of us.
This town ain't big enough. And then there's a song about that will end in a slaw shootout with salad shooters.
That's original.
Good for you.
Thank
it's really
you.
It's really off the wall funny. I like it.
Thank you very much.
You got a nice idea.
But I don't know what the love story is. I mean, probably just with coleslaw, right?
No, it's coleslaw, but maybe it's Mueller.
I think so.
I think that's got.
I think it's got to be that, right?
Get him off the cam and back up.
Yeah. I don't know if she really loves the slaw. That could be the love story.
Well, there is the love of slaw. It's unspoken law. No, it's fun. It's
thank
fun.
You so much.
Yeah. I have a question. You know, of course, when you write a musical like this, it's really fun. It's larger than life, but maybe it has some kind of parallel that you're intending to, you know. I was just wondering if you guys had something in mind that you were trying to make a, you know, someone coming to town. Is there some kind of real life?
Not really. I kind of was using Western tropes where mysterious stranger comes in and changes things. Mm-hmm. And But I do also find that when I do write what's supposed to be funny, I sneak in a line about like the prairie being, you get trapped in your wide open space. And then I find like, oh, maybe that's what I'm writing about. But not intentionally. I don't ever mean anything intentionally.
No, but that's okay. Something, you know, I felt that too, that there was something going on, undercurrent of, that this is a serious problem. Come into our town, and we're settled here, and what are you doing? Destroying our little paradise. But, you know, something like that. This more to the sloth than you realize.
There always is.
Thank you very much.
Do you want to come back?
Yeah, sure. Let's go back up there. Questions? Someone might have dropped their prop, or it could be like a Starbucks receipt. I don't know. So let's just open it up completely. What questions do you have for Tom?
I guess this kind of unintentionally dovetails on what we're working on, but do you have any suggestions for amping up the comedy in a script, just generally comedy writing in general?
Well, what I don't like are jokes. Jokes are something I think you don't want to write. Let all the comedy come out of the situation of people. And there are some. All those Neil Simon plays were so full of jokes. They were great hits at their time, but they don't play very well anymore. I don't think people like those jokes. Something Rotten, the new musical, is very funny, but it's a lot of jokes. It's a lot of bad jokes. It's kind of charming, but I don't think it has real legs because it's not. It's too jokey. There's just sometimes something that's meant to be a joke is not a good idea. But to be funny, it's good. And to be boring about coleslaw is funny. It's not a joke. It's real. She really has slaw, yes.
Well, going off of that, what do you think of the Book of Mormon? Is that more jokey, or is it
no,
more
so, the comedy is the comedy is true, but there are very few jokes in that show. The comedy is wonderful. And it's the same comedy as South Park. South Park is an amazing, funny show. Brilliant, brilliant. And talk about, subtext and serious subjects. South Park attacks them all. And so there's the Book of Mormon. The Book of Mormon is a serious comedy.
It's good.
It says a lot. It really is. It's a terrific show. It's one of the reasons that it's so successful. But it's not just jokes. It's a serious piece of work. That's the genius of that. Yes?
Do you think at all in terms of those structural things that people talk about, like rising action, climax, and denouement, or some version of that?
Well, you kind of instinctively do it. You don't really say, this is where we're going to do that. It sort of happens. If you construct it correctly, those things are going to be there. They're sort of textbook things that you don't think about. And I never think, I got to put this in here. If you have a feeling for storytelling, you can almost tell right away. It's no more different than sitting and telling somebody a story, instead of telling a child a story. It should have a beginning, a middle, and an end. And always, in my case, I have happy endings, pretty much, except death takes a holiday, not so happy. But in general, I think, as I said before for a moment, that I think all musicals are sort of like fairy tales. There's something about them that they can be very elemental and simple. On the surface, they may seem more complicated. Deep down, they should become a simple, traditional story. I realized only after I wrote Annie, it had been running a couple of years, Cinderella. And then I realized, then I saw the Hairspray for Cinderella. Cinderella is a kind of story that we told over and over again as we see it. Cinderella movies are coming out every week. But also, there are lots and lots of fairy tales that I think traditional legendary fairy tales are worth thinking about as kind of a, as something you're not consciously doing, but unconsciously you create those fairy tales, recreate them. So you're allowed to do bizarre things in musicals because of the unreality of bursting into someone in the middle of the street or whatever, that they can be quite extraordinary in terms of reality sometimes because they're singing and dancing already it's breaking reality.
I'm sort of curious as to your thoughts on the sort of plotless review type musicals, like Company or Chorus Line. They have books, I think they're good books, but they have very clear dramatic arcs, but not really a plot in the conventional sense. So I'm sort of curious, what are your thoughts on that sort of thing?
Well, those are two very successful shows that I like very much, but they do not have to kind of, I think Company is a bunch of really terrific numbers and songs. Not the book is not good. It's, in my opinion, the reason it isn't done that much is because it doesn't really. I mean, we have Bobby, but Bobby's Dilemma. It's not really a book musical. It's a lot of songs. Could be in any show. There's a bunch of songs. They're all not songs. They're so good. I couldn't write a musical like that. It's not my kind of musical. The Chorus Line is another terrific show. Of course, it's multiple stories, which is not at all what I would do. I couldn't write a show. I always feel that you focus on one or two people. Because if you're going to have 12 people, whatever it is, the Chorus Line, I don't see that. I've always been somewhat surprised at the success of this. It's Michael Bennett's great work, I think, and the score is terrific. And it is. It's a group of underdogs, many half of them win, half of them lose. So there is that kind of overall story. There is a kind of beauty contest sort of feel about who's going to win. But it's not my idea of great books, either of those shows. Yes?
You talked before about the kind of magic of being in the room all together during the collaboration.
Yes.
I'm wondering if performers have ever been part of that collaboration in your process?
Very rarely. Almost always it's just that the creators do it. But when the first day of rehearsal, when you get the people in there, that's when the performers start to be collaborators, even though they don't realize it, or they do realize it. Some performers can give you so much. It comes off the page in a way. It's thrilling to think maybe this is okay, and then somebody, a good performer, makes it really good. And once in a while, you'll find a performer will come up with a different line, or a different lyric line, or whatever. And if it's good, it's in. There's no reason to say we didn't write that. Someone like Nathan Lane, once in a while, will come up with a joke, the comedy line. It's everybody together once you get in that room. It's a total collaboration, which is fine. It's one of the most exciting times in any show. It's the first day of rehearsal, and that's weeks of rehearsal. When you're discovering the show for yourself, it's been on the paper, you've heard it on the piano. It's something else from the side of the speaker.
I actually have a quick question building on that. Going back to the comedy, I watched an interesting interview where you talked about how obviously a lot of the comedy comes from the characters, and about how, one of the funniest lines in Annie is when Daddy Warbuck says to Annie, who's upset, "Oh, I'll get her a brandy," which I admire very much. I was wondering, because my question was going to be if actors help in that kind of discovering humor in the characters. But, I guess before actors come on board, how do you find that humor in the characters so you're not making jokes, but you're, does it come from exploring what's larger than life about them? Do you have certain
like tips about that?
Well, in that instance, there was a very strong dramatic scene with Annie where he tries to give her a new locket and she rejects it. And she doesn't burst into tears because we never want Annie to cry. But she lets him know that she doesn't want him as her father. She wants him to find, wants to find a real mother and father. So there's terrific emotional tension. And it's a moment that you want to burst. You, and it's a great moment to do so, to have somebody say something so wrong so that he gets a laugh. And I'll get her a brandy, is that.
Yeah.
he doesn't know what to do. And the thing he thinks of is, in emergency, give him a brandy. Girls, to get her brandy has always been particularly with some of the very good people we've had play war books. It's always a big laugh because it bursts that bubble from building up. You stick a pin in it, it's a laugh. Yeah, obviously, that's an example of something that's not a joke. I'll get her brandy is not a joke, but it's a laugh. It's a human moment.
You've written for a lot of different, but very specific characters. I'm wondering what kind of work you do to kind of discover their voices and the vernacular that it's appropriate for them?
Yeah, well, I do make a careful study of the, like it, when we're working on Hairspray, I wanted to get into that real Baltimore sound as soft as people. We went down to Baltimore and went around to look at the city and met a lot of people and discussed it. We did have John Waters' film. A typical John Waters film, it's just like, looked like it was made for $20 in the backyard. But there was a lot in it. It's interesting with John Waters is that he makes some really interesting low budget films with good ideas and then always goofs up in the middle. It feels like he had an idea and then forgot about it. The second half of his movies are always just chaos. He totally rewrote it, changed the second half of Hairspray. But I do try to get my ear attuned to where the people are, who they are, the way they talk, their language, rhythm of speech, all that is important to me. Certainly in Annie, I researched language because I looked at a lot of movies that were made in 1932 and 33, so that the slang in Annie was authentic to the period. I always feel those sort of things are important, and that kind of detail. I do that in all the shows.
I have a question about producers in Young Frankenstein. I mean, you're dealing with two incredibly iconic movies that many people can recite from beginning to end movies.
Yeah.
And you're working with Mel on both of these things. And how, before you get to the rehearsal room, how difficult was it going through the original screenplays and deciding what you can keep and what, you know, those moments where, was there a lot of fighting over, we can't dump this, we have to keep this,
the answer to that is yes. There was a lot of back and forth on that. There were a lot of lines in both movies that Mel didn't want to give up. And I said, well, you know, remember that they can go buy these movies and watch them on DVD. We can't just present the same script on the stage. You have to rethink it and get new lines. There are some, in both cases, there are some iconic lines from the original movies that are still there because we weren't going to dump them. But in producers, we dumped whole characters, like Dick Jones' character and people like that, and tried to make it. We changed the tone of it quite a bit. But you've got to be careful in doing a movie that there's certain expectations. If you do Young Frankenstein, she's got to say he was my boyfriend. You know, make it into a song, make it too much. But, There are certain, as you say, iconic lines that we do want to keep. But Mel is the most wonderful guy in the world. He's absolutely funny from dawn till dusk. We just say the craziest, funniest things all the time. But he can be very difficult to work with. The other thing is he procrastinates even more than I do. Procrastinate or go out to California to work with him. And we're going to meet in his office at 10 a.m. and start. I get to his office at 10 a.m., he gets there at noon. He has to answer phone calls and stuff like that, so let's go to lunch. And I said, we could have lunch here at the desk. No, let's go to Beverly Hills, driving from 20 miles here to a restaurant in Beverly Hills, and then come back and be back at 3. But usually we would get in about around 4 o'clock to 5:30, we would work. That's why a movie could take 3 years to write. It should take 3 months to write. But it was always fun. It was kind of an adventure. He's still going strong. He was 89 yesterday. And he's still top of his game as far as brains and humor go. He's not quite as fast on his feet as he used to be. He's still there.
Are you actually working on the musical Blazing Saddles together?
No. That's where I stopped. We'd done the two, and then he said he wanted to do Blazing Saddles, and I said, Blazing Saddles is not a musical. The other two, Young Frankenstein, was hard, very hard to make into a musical. But I don't think Blazing Saddles is a Broadway musical. And I think it's a terrifically funny movie, and it's charming. Horses and people driving around punching horses and knocking their dad. My entire dance fans out in the desert and all kind. You know, it's a Western takeoff, and I don't. Your Western musical may make it, but most Westerns don't make good musicals. There have been several attempts. I don't think there's ever been a real successful musical that also makes up is a Western. It's a genre of its own. It's a movie genre. I don't think it's a theater genre. It's probably one great question I've forgotten. I don't think so.
When you are writing the first draft of a book, do you try and write lyrically, with the intention that somebody's going to set those words to a song, or do you just write straight dialogue?
Oh, I write straight dialogue, and then often they'll say, this could be a song here. Actually, when I write my long outline,